Again, good morning to all of you. So glad that you're here. Grateful for some guests that we have with us today. That you feel welcome. And all of our guests, this morning, why don't you, if you didn't today, welcome. If we have one for you, the front entrance, we'd love for you to pick one of those up. So there are some points. And thanks for being here with us today. Thanks to our online viewers. Always grateful for folks who are able to join us online. Grateful for the thanks of technology and whatever else folks who can't be here on time. Well, as we begin today, I have some important reminders for you. You've noticed we have finished up the month of January that we have launched into this year of 2023 with this focus of For the One. It's our commitment to, first and foremost, strengthen the one relationship that matters most for you, and that's our relationship with Jesus. Other relationships have value in our lives, but if we don't have that relationship, nothing else matters. So we're going to be talking a lot throughout this year about things of discipleship. What does it mean to lean into this call to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus? And we're providing for you a number of ways for you to do that. I just want to remind you that there's a reading plan. If you want to work your way reading through the Bible in this calendar year, you'll find reading plans out on the main info board on the shelf. If you didn't pick one up from a few weeks back, I want to encourage you to dig into God's Word. Here in the month of February, we are reading some of the letters of Paul. So we've been reading in Galatians and Ephesians. I think so we'll be reading in Philippians. Another way that you can deepen your faith is through prayer. We've provided for you a prayer calendar for the month of February. We're praying this month for those who serve in ministry. Right now, we're kind of leading into those who are in children's ministry, but we've been praying for leaders. If you don't have one of those prayer calendars, again, main info boards and prayer way. Pray to people with those up. And then you heard Mallory announce this just a few minutes ago. But next week, we launch into what's called the 40 Days of Discipleship, which is a small group experience that's going to carry us through the weeks of Lent all the way up until Easter time. There is still time for you to sign up. If you'd like to know who is leading and what day of the week that their group is meeting and so forth, there's additional information out there on the desk there on the table. So you can see who's leading. But I certainly want to encourage you to be a part of that experience. But I know that for some folks, they're perhaps not quite there yet. The thought of meeting in somebody's home and being in a smaller group or maybe have to talk a little bit more is maybe it's not a great place to come from. Size school, we would love for you to plug into size school. It's a parent pit stop for parents with kids. We can stay upstairs. There's two classes to be done. They would like some other opportunities for you to grow. Maybe that's maybe a little place of uncomfort. You struggle maybe to get up early on Sunday mornings. Well, I'm going to invite you on Wednesday nights. 6:30 is our Bible study time here at the church. We meet in the sanctuary. This is the very informal time of sharing together the things we want. There are lots of places for you to grow. When we talk about faith matters, when we talk about things of discipleship, I don't know if you pay much attention to the culture around us, but every time they do either nationwide surveys or they do the census data, it's always amazing at the number of people they claim here in the United States to be Christian. But what are the indications that they really are Christians? What is the mark of being a disciple? Can you be a Christian and not be a disciple? Or do the two go together? Well, some people equate being a Christian means that they simply attend the church every now and then. That's enough for them. That counts as being a Christian. Statistics also show that when people say that they are a regular church attender, in our present culture, if you attend church less than 50% in any given month of the year, people think that's regular attendance. It's an interesting statistic. There are some people who say, well, I'm a Christian because I throw money in the offering plate every now and then. Which one? Well, every now and then I'll pray over my meal at home. That must make me a Christian. There are a lot of folks that own Bibles. And sadly, there are a lot of folks that the only time their Bible is open is perhaps when they've gone to church on Sunday morning and it gets closed and it's not on the shelf. They'll never see it again until the time they come next week. But all those things have value as a disciple. But are they enough to really be a disciple? So today, as a part of answering that question, we're going to begin a brand new sermon series. You're going to find the graphic on the screen behind me today. It's called One Fruit, Many Flavors. It's a series that is taken from Galatians chapter 5, the Fruit of the Spirit passage. It's a text that Paul is using to address the church on some important truths about what it means what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus. And Paul is very clear. Being a follower of Jesus is not simply just doing some exterior things. While exterior things have value, to really be a follower of Jesus, to be a disciple, is an inward work in our spirit. So that's what we're going to lean into over the next number of weeks together. If you have your Bible, you want to turn with me to the book of Galatians. We're going to go to Galatians chapter 5. We've gone through Acts and Romans, you get through Corinthians, and we get to these short letters of Paul. And while you're turning to Galatians chapter 5, let me give you just a little bit of background about the book and about the chapter. Galatians is one of Paul's letters to the churches, not to a single church, but to many churches. These were churches that he founded on his first missionary journey. He writes this letter somewhere, scholars believe, between 50 and 60 or so in AD. So 20 or so years after Jesus died and was resurrected and returned to heaven. These churches in Galatia, if you know anything about modern geography, the reason that Galatia is where modern Turkey lies today. Incidentally, some of you have followed the news and you've seen the news stories about the people of Turkey and the earthquakes that have occurred, the earthquake that occurred there. Sadly, this morning I opened up the news and now the death toll is rising somewhere around 28 or 30,000 people. And the count is another one. Pray for the people of Turkey, pray for the church in Turkey. Our guest speaker who was with us last week, I connected with him during the week. I asked if he had still family connections or friends from their time as refugees in Turkey. He said yes, and we've not heard from them. Pray for the people of Turkey. And that's where Paul is sending this letter. Chapter 5 is packed full of all kinds of truth for us about what it means to be a follower of Christ, including the fruit of the Spirit, which is our specific focus. In the chapter, Paul contrasts two different ways of life. He begins at the beginning of the chapter talking about it in terms of one way of life enslaves a person. But another way of life actually produces freedom. And he talks about it this way. He talks about the burden of the Old Testament law. If you're trying to live under the weight of that, that actually enslaves you. That's a heavy burden. But Paul also says that there is grace and freedom in Jesus Christ. And that's where we are called to live. Paul says the law, just simply following outward rules, will never change you on the inside. We need the way of Jesus to win grace. Paul speaks of it in terms of life by the flesh and life by the Spirit. It's two different ways of thinking about it. We see that beginning in verse 16, and we'll pick the text up there in a little bit. He says in verse 17 that these two ways are in opposition to each other. The way of the flesh is kind of fighting against, and I should say kind of, it is fighting against the life of the Spirit. And what Paul calls us to is again more than just simply our behaviors and actions. He's calling us this life of the Spirit and following Jesus will radically change us outside and inside. And with that in mind, let's look then to the text. Let's start in verse 16, chapter 5. And Paul says this, "But I say to you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. But if you're led by the Spirit, you are not under the law." There's that two ways of living. "Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousies, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. Of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But," here's where the story turns, "but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified position with God doesn't move us from a place of being guilty to a place of being forgiven. Our life in Christ actually moves us in a very practical way to life change. It's a radical life change. The language of transformation is all over the writing of Paul in Galatians, but also in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, and so on. What is the language of transformation that Paul talks about? Well, he said it several times in this text. He says things like, walk by the Spirit. Be led by the Spirit. Keep in step by the Spirit. And that may be a bit hard to understand, so let me give you another passage from Paul's writing. This comes to us from the book of Colossians, chapter 3. I think this is a little bit more illustrative of what it means. Paul says this. You'll find this verse on the screen behind me there. He says this. You have left your old sinful life. You see, a transformation is taking place. You're going to leave behind something. Your old way of living, your old sinful life, and all the things that you did before. And you've begun to live a new life. There's a transformation that is taking place now. As a father or his wife, there's a new way of living. Paul goes on to say this. In which you are being made new. And you're becoming. See, that word becoming is a word of transformation. You're being changed into something. What does he say? You are becoming like the one who made you. When we become a follower of Jesus Christ, there is a transformation that begins. And I'll be very frank with you. It begins at the moment of your salvation, and it will last until God calls you home. Death is actually the great sanctifier, because all that remains in our life that is yet like Christ, when we die and go to be with the Lord, that is completely done. But until that time, He is always at work, always molding, always shaping, always making us into that new thing. God's will for your life, for my life, is transformation. And now, here in Galatians chapter 5, Paul takes a different word to it. You see, he gives us an image, a metaphor, as you read, as it were, to what this transformation looks like. He says, there should be fruit. Fruit is the evidence of discipleship. It's the evidence of being made new. Now, why did Paul use such a metaphor? Because we all understand fruit. If I were to say to you, and we even have a few kids in the room today, if I said the word apple, almost instantly in your mind's eye, imagine, you know what that fruit looks like. If I said orange or banana, you immediately know what fruit is. You can almost picture an apple tree laden with apples. That tree is healthy. How do we know that it's healthy? But it's bearing fruit. It's a great metaphor to use for us. The word that Paul uses, though, is not a word that means apple or banana or orange. The word fruit that Paul uses is a word that means offspring, deed, action, result, or present. Fruit on a tree is the evidence of a healthy, growing tree, but fruit in the life of a believer is the evidence of a healthy, growing walk of faith, meaning there should be a result of your walk. I have great concern for people that say they have journeyed in their faith for countless years, yet when we examine their life, they don't look much like Jesus. It makes you wonder where their fruit is. How can one claim to be a follower of Christ if fruit is not growing? That it's not being developed. You see, your relationship, my relationship with Jesus, should produce fruit. There should be a result that should produce fruit. In fact, Jesus said, if you were to go and read in John chapter 15, which is a great passage for you to read and study. Jesus says, I have chosen you. I have appointed you to bear fruit. In fact, he says, if you don't abide in me, you're not going to bear any fruit. It's an important call as a follower of Jesus that fruit is being formed in our lives. Paul says in our text in John, we're in Galatians chapter 5, there's an old way of living that has its own fruit, as it were. He uses the word works. That way of living is different than living by the Spirit. increase and grow is the fruit of the Spirit in our life, in your life, in mine. He says, live by the Spirit, walk by the Spirit, be led by the Spirit. Paul doesn't do that just for fun, just to fill up the gaps. He is using that language to remind us that the fruit that we are called to bear as followers of Jesus will never come in our own effort. You may try and be patient, and by sheer willpower and effort, you may be patient for a short period of time. But make no mistake, God is going to find you in a place where your patience will be tested. And if you are not walking by, living by, being led by the Spirit, having the fruit of the Spirit in your life, you're going to have to have some time, and your patience will be out there. Parents that have young children, sometimes you're on your last nerve with those kids. It's too hard to hold on to your patience. If you're trying to do this by human effort, there are all kinds of self-help books. I'm not saying that self-help in itself is completely wrong. But if self is your solution to developing this fruit, you're going to find yourself greatly disappointed because self is actually the problem. That's why Paul says you shouldn't live by the flesh. Don't live by yourself anymore. Live by the Spirit. So the question we have to answer is, are we trying to live a transformed life in our own flesh? Strength or wisdom, or we try to live it for the power of the Holy Spirit. One last key detail about this idea of fruit of the Spirit, just that verse itself. Please note that the word fruit is singular. The word fruit is singular. Live and have the fruit of the Spirit. This is one fruit that has to get expressed in many flavors, as it were. The call to be a follower of Jesus Christ, the call to live by the Spirit, means that all of these flavors, as it were, should be present in your life. Now, they may be stronger than others at times, or some of them may be more refined than others at times. But you do not have the option of saying, well, I like the fruit of love, or I like the fruit of joy, I don't really want to be bothered by that little thing of patience, or that little thing of kindness. We don't have that option. If we are bearing the fruit of the Spirit, if we are living in the things of the Spirit, all of these should and will be present in your life. And to the degree that they're not, is to the degree that you and I depend on living by the Spirit. So let's talk about today's flavor. I'm going to borrow from the ice cream store mentality. Why do I do that? Well, it's just fun for me. But everybody knows what I'm talking about when you say flavor of the day. It's the flavor that they're trying to put out there. Well, this is the one that's before us today. Flavor of love. But what kind of love? Which love is Paul talking about? So you've seen these next words on this slide. There are a lot of words that mean love in the Greek language. There's eros love. That's physical attraction. It's the sexual aspect of love. A valid form of love, but an inferior form of love. There's philia. It's the kind of love that we have for our close friendship. There's storge love. That's the love that we have in family relationships. Eros, philia, storge. All important kinds of love, but we cannot build our lives on that kind of love. And that is not the love that we spoke about in the Holy Spirit. The highest form of love is agape love. It is the love which seeks the highest good of other people. It is the love that is sacrificial, that is unconditional. This is the word that Paul uses in the text. The fruit of the Spirit is agape. It's beyond natural affection. It's beyond simple loyalty to family. This is loving people when they're not easy to love. If you have been married for any length of time, or if you've had children for any length of time, or just plain and simple, if you've been around people for any length of time, you know that there are some people that are easier to love than others. Agape says, you have no doubt. You are called to love them no matter what. spouse in. So therefore, I will leave my spouse and I'll find someone that I will attract. Those lesser forms of love, they are temporary, do not stick around. Agape is here no matter what. It is an unbreakable commitment, and that's why agape is what our marriage vows are built on. It's why we pledge to our spouses for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. You see, Philias, Gorgon, and Eros, they don't pledge themselves. They pledge only as long as you need my needs, what am I in this relationship? Agape says, I am here for the long haul. It is this kind of love that should be evidence in the life of a believer. I would also contend that it is agape that must rule all the other forms of love. You see, if I'm operating out of agape, and I find somebody that doesn't meet my needs, I'm still going to love them. They're still going to be my friend, even if they perhaps disagree with me, or they've done something to hurt them. Agape love will stay committed to that answer. In fact, I would also suggest to you that if you go back and read again the list of the works of the flesh that Paul talks about in chapter 5, the works of the flesh are actually disordered love. They're disordered kinds of love. They're built on those temporary things. So when it talks about all those things of sexual immorality and impurity, you see, that's Eros that has gone wrong. That's Eros that is not governed by the agape love of God, the work of the Spirit of God. We need agape love. So what is the source of agape love? What's the source of agape love? What is God himself? Go with me farther into the New Testament, almost to the end of the book of 1 John. Do you know anything about the Apostle John? He's actually referred to as the Apostle of Love because he speaks so much about his love. And in 1 John chapter 4, we hear some incredible words from John about love. Look with me at verse 8 of chapter 4. The one who does not love does not know God. Why is that true? Because God is love. Go to verse 16. We have come to know and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. God provides love, abides in God, and God abides in love. You see, God doesn't just show love to us. It's not a character quality of Him in the way that we think of a character quality for us. It's His very nature. If we want to experience agape love, if we want to have that fruit growing in our lives, then we must turn to the source, which is God Himself. We see that agape love from God demonstrated most perfectly on the cross. Scripture tells us that while we were yet in our sin, while we were unloved, while we were standing against the things of God, or as Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, the things of the flesh, they're actually in opposition, they're butting heads with the things of the Spirit. God says, I love you. If I love you so much, I'm going to send my son to take your sin upon himself to die and prove that cross so that we might have a restored relationship. The Apostle John also tells us that not only is God himself love, but he tells us that any ability that you and I have to show agape love comes from God. Look at verse 19 of chapter 4. We love, why? Because He first loved us. Now, it is possible, even in our own humanness, to display evidence of agape love with one another, apart from the work of the Spirit, apart from God's control of our heart. But this is what is true. You will never, ever sustain that kind of love unless He is at work in your life, transformed by the Spirit. If you want to have the fruit of agape love, we must submit to the transforming work of the Spirit in our lives. Let's go back to Galatians chapter 5. Fruit of the Spirit is love, He says. I do not believe it is by God's love that Paul begins unpacking the flavors of this fruit. The word love, I believe that love is a first in order and first in importance. First in order and first in importance. How do I know you, Jesus. I'd like to know, what are the greatest commands that we can obey? And where does Jesus begin? Love, Lord, your God. Heart, soul, mind, strength. Second command is right up there with us, but love your neighbor as yourself. Love is of first importance. In fact, we believe that as we truly realize that a part of our mission statement as a church is that we are called to love God. But it is important for our witness to the world that agape love is the fruit that is being born in our hearts. Paul also speaks of the far-reaching impact of the Spirit's transforming our love, verse 13 in chapter 5 of Galatians. For you were called to freedom, brothers, only don't turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. Paul says it's so important. Why? Because it guards against a heart that becomes selfish and is only looking out for number one. And it moves us then to serve. The people's of first in order, first in importance. Paul would go on to say in Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, that love is the essential key to unity in the body of Christ. We talked about the oneness of the body of Christ last month in our series together. Where does that unity come from? Comes from agape, growing more and more in our heart. We could go to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, and Paul gives the admonition that we are to walk in love. And that word walk means to regulate your life by it, to conduct yourself, to be occupied with it. You and I are called for the transforming work of the Spirit to let love guide every single thing that we do. It should be our code of conduct in life with our families, with our spouses, with our children, with our neighbors, with our co-workers, whoever it would be, love should guide everything we do. We would then say in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 14, that love should be the universal focus. Let everything be done in love. Love is the first importance. That's what we're searching for. As I draw towards the close today, let's give a little practical. What is being transformed by the Spirit? What is love look like in our lives? What does the Spirit's work do for us in regards to love? Well, here's what the work of the Spirit will do in us as we submit to Him. It will move us from temporary forms of love to unbreakable commitment. Our love for one another. That's how the Spirit transforms us. It will move us from those lower loves of Eros and Philia and Storge to agape. The world does temporary love really, really well. Doesn't take too much to look around to know that is true. The world does temporary love really, really well. Left to ourselves in our flesh, as Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, left to our flesh, we will revert to temporary love. This is who we are. As fallen human beings, apart from this transforming work, temporary is where we live. We may try to do something permanent, but in the flesh, it's really good. That's what it's going to do. The Spirit will move us from temporary to committed. Committed to what? Well, first and foremost, you and I, as part of the Spirit's transformation, will help us be committed to our loves for God. Committed to our loves for God. For the one, that's our theme for this year, not just our sermon series in January. Luke chapter 10. Verse 27, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind. places, he transforms me. Transforms my obedience to his commands. By myself, I can't do that. Transform your heart with the Spirit. And then transform your love for God. He will change you into your commitment of love for God. He will move you to place of commitment to other people. 1 John chapter 4, he talks about loving the brethren, the family of God, the brothers and sisters in the faith. You will become ever more increasing, whatever language you want to use. You will become increasingly committed in your love for the brothers and sisters. If you go out on the main info board today, you're going to find a thank you card from Rance and Susan. They are thanking the church for their prayers for Rance before his surgery, during the surgery, in his recovery. They're thanking the body of Christ for bringing him meals, for praying for them, for calling and checking in on them. That is the body that is expressing commitment to somebody else. Why? There's been words of thanks that I expressed by Sonny for the prayers of the loss of a loved one of her family. That's a commitment to the body of Christ. That's how people transform their love. I've already said it. Matthew chapter 5, Sermon on the Mount. Your love for even your enemies, he will transform. The flesh is hard to do, but through the Spirit, we can. 1 John chapter 3, it challenges us to love those who are in need. It says, don't just love with words, don't just love with slogans of truth. He says, love with actions, with your whole life. Care for those who are in need. One of the greatest ways that we can express that is there are people outside the family. Stand in need of your saving, redeeming lives. Do we love them enough? Do we care for them enough? Are we concerned for them enough? We will share Jesus with them. In our flesh, that's hard to do. The power of the Spirit is transforming work as that fruit begins to grow. We can care for those outside of us. You see, if we love God, then we have to love what God loves. And God loves all those who are outside of us. He loves us with everything. Transform that in your life. Mother, husbands, wives, parents with your children, God wants to transform your life for God. He wants you to have a deep, committed love for your children that says, I love you no matter what. It's that First Corinthians kind of love, and that's the work that he wants to do. I'm going to invite my worship team back up as we close today just with some simple questions about your love. How would you describe your love for God today? Is your love for God white hot? Is it lukewarm? Or is it ice cold? And if you answered two out of the three, then I'm going to suggest to you today that the Spirit has some transforming work that he needs to do. Do you struggle to love other people with Christ-like love? That's a struggle for you, but there is room for the Spirit's transformation in your life. There is a measure of that fruit that is yet to be sprouting and blooming and coming forth. Either of those two questions, they are only answered by our willingness to surrender that bargain. Are we willing to surrender to His transforming work in the church where we say it's the sanctifying work of the Spirit? Are we willing to surrender to the transforming work of the Spirit? If you've already surrendered that, are you continuing to surrender to the work of the Spirit day in and day out so that the fruit of the Spirit is evident to you? Fruit will never be achieved by the Spirit when it comes when we abide. Are you abiding in Him? So I just want to invite you to stay with me this morning by our prayers. God, I pray today that you would move and work in hearts. But Lord, where there is perhaps a need for one in this room or one watching online to surrender for the first time, or perhaps surrender even greater control of our heart and life to you, so that the work of the Spirit, the transforming work, can bring up agape love in our lives, our love for you, and our love for others. Father, forgive us for being trying to live out love in our own strength. We have tried. Christ, they